key of the worshipers. Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go.
Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, we're going to learn how clove extract lowers your blood sugar from St. Thomas College in India. And that's important because we have almost 100 million people just in the United States who either have diabetes diagnosed or those who are undiagnosed and have prediabetes, meaning they're overweight and they have metabolic disorders. So this will help them. We have about 10 other important articles also. Then, as I promised yesterday, we are in the fifth week of what is a 12-week program, and we're going to give you a little feedback, not on the blood workup, because we won't have that for another 4 weeks, and that has to go to a scientific committee before we have a chance to see it. But all the other things that have changed, things we can actually measure and have, we're going to share that with you. Also, we're going to have some different input today. For example, from Honest Government, we're going to hear about health care. This is a short minute, 30-second clip, but I think you'll enjoy it. Also, we're going to start a lot on the environment, because we need to be honest about what we're facing. I believe well-intentioned people, as I mentioned yesterday, are not aware if we planted, and we should, but if we planted hundreds of billions of trees, it would not stop the tipping points that we're facing. Also, for those ultra-conservative scientists, which are most of them, they've been telling us it's not going to happen anytime near. Well, why don't you tell that to the people living in California, from the top to the bottom of the state? Hundreds of thousands of people are being adversely affected. Millions of people are without electricity for periods of time, 1 day, 2 days. And this means that everything is going to keep happening over and over and over again. At what point will people realize you're living in an unsustainable environment? Now, that's right now. In fact, I could mention, as of right now, because I've studied every morning when I turn on my computer and I take a look at the weather, extreme weather events around the world, there's more than 60 countries that are having extreme weather events in the last week alone. Just here in the United States, down in Iowa, they went to 30 below zero. Well, when you have a 60-degree swing in 1 day, a lot of animals outside are going to die. Didn't have to, but the people didn't plan on. Why don't we put some bales of hay and make a windbreak? 3 bales deep, 8 foot high. The animals can go inside. If nothing else, they're not going to get that wind chill. And then you put about 1 foot of hay on the ground, and that'll at least allow them to congregate together and save their lives. What do you want to bet that didn't happen one time? So we really are... In fact, I'm going to ask you this question. Why do you believe that no matter what it is we should do, 97% of the population will resist it, make excuses, and not do it, even when their own life is at stake? I'd like to hear from you, please. Give us a call at 888-874-4888. And throughout the program, in between some clips and discussion, I'd like to hear your point of view. We have a fetish about making wrong choices or allowing others to make them on our behalf and then defending those people who make these wrong choices. 888-874-4888. No commentary today, because I want you to hear about, unemployment, low wages, and I'm going to give you some positive solutions for each one of these that you're going to hear. So we're going to look at the problem and look at solutions in climate change and in the economy. So that's what we're going to do. And we always begin with the latest on health and healing. And by the way, before we go there, please write down these numbers, because you never know on any station where we're syndicated around America when one day you turn it on and I'm not there. So this way you can always hear the show Monday to Friday, noon to 1, and Tuesday evening, 7 to 8 o'clock. In fact, last night on the Progressive Commentary, it was so riveting, Ray McGovern, that we went for an entire second hour and nothing was repeated. All great insights. If you want to hear that one, you'll go to our archive. It's now posted. Our archive number is 701-719-9976. 701-719-9976. But to listen live, 774-337-6068. Again, 774-337-6068. Now, to the issue of helping people with diabetes, a study showed that the polyphenolic-rich clove extract significantly lowers after-meal blood sugar by up to 21%, and in pre-diabetics, 27%. When our ability to metabolize blood sugar breaks down, it sets off a cascade of harmful events that accelerates systemic aging. By the way, those who have diabetes or high blood sugar, you're aging a lot faster than everyone else. Even high normal blood sugar raises heart disease and stroke risk substantially. Now, this loss of glucose control motivated scientists to evaluate whether an extract from cloves can lower elevated blood sugar. In this pilot study, standardized clove extract was tested on healthy people as well as those with prediabetes. The study results found lower after-meal blood sugar, that's normally when your blood sugar goes up after a meal, in healthy adults and prediabetics supplemented with clove extract. So that's very good. That's good information. In fact, one of the things I've suggested for a long time is when you have a meal, afterwards, don't go lay down, don't go sit down. Instead, go for a moderately paced walk. That will stimulate better digestion, it will improve circulation, and it will bring down that elevated post-blood sugar glucose level. This was published in the British Medical Complementary and Alternative Medicine Journal. Next up, treating inflammation helps resolve depression. This is from Huazhong University of Science in China, and it was published in the peer-reviewed Journal of Neurology and Neurosurgery and Psychiatry. And what it's showing is something that many of us in the field have seen. In fact, I've done not one but two studies on depression and anxiety. These are clinical trials, non-medical, though they were supervised with board-certified neurologists. And this is based upon a meta-analysis, meaning you take a lot of different studies on the same topic, and you try to find elements that give you an indication of where the mean level is of benefit from something or harm from something. And what this meta-analysis showed was the anti-inflammatory compounds among men and women with major depression, which means, in lay language, when you're depressed or you're anxious, your stress hormones really go up. That's bad. And as a result, you get a lot of free radicals and oxidative stress. That's really, really bad. And that can destroy your cells, damage your cells, and cause defects in your DNA. That's super bad. So those of you who are depressed or anxious, mindful meditation, aerobic exercise, tapping therapy, yoga, biofeedback, there are a lot of different ways of approaching depression. But it doesn't work when you do the antidepressive and antipsychotic medications. I never recommend those for anyone. So this way, when you turn off inflammation, going on a healthy plant-based diet, taking lots of high-quality alkalizing juices, like lemon water in the morning, that's a terrific way to start the day. And then having green juices throughout the day, having watermelon, tomatoes, raspberries, strawberries, those red fruits, very good for you. And that lowers inflammation. By the way, you want the superstars of lowering inflammation? Let me tell you the superstars. They can outwork any non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. Omega-3 fatty acids. The minocycline, the the vitamin C, quercetin, pycnogenol, vitamin E, and zinc combination. Those really sop up all of your anti-inflammatories. Then if you want the two most important ones you can take for inflammation, this is for any condition, would be black cumin seed oil, dilute it into a smoothie because it's a little hard to take, and curcumin. So that's what they found. So get on a healthy lifestyle, lower your levels of stress, lower inflammation, and that's what is the best way of approaching stress and anxiety conditions. From Carnegie Mellon University comes a study, an 8-week study, about mindfulness-based stress reduction. And the study found that mindfulness skills is crucial for stress. The new study suggests that practicing acceptance helps reduce our stress more than simple mindful awareness. So what do I mean? I mean, we all know this. Life can be extremely stressful, whether it's the stress that comes from having too much work to do in too little time, or fulfilling caregiving obligations, or dealing with a major illness or setback. It's difficult to cope all the time. So in this study, the participants learned to be mindful and pay attention to their present moment experiences in an accepting, non-judgmental way. And that made an enormous difference. Let me explain how I do this myself. I have to look at a problem for what it is. I did a commentary yesterday. It's now posted, by the way. And I simply connected a lot of different pieces to the puzzle. And I'll give you an example, and I'm not going to go through the whole discussion, but when I look around, I see, why do so many good people do so many bad things? Why do smart people do stupid things? Why do people who should make a good choice make a bad choice? Why don't people make any choice? Why do people always equivocate? Why do people resist? Why don't people be taking a position after they've done their mindful research, done their homework, and know that they're on the right side of an issue, like challenge the safety and efficacy of vaccines? That's completely legitimate. And yet you're made to feel like you are somehow a domestic health terrorist. And that's what the Washington Post would like you to believe, or the New York Times. They've actually said as much in editorials, how dangerous you are to a society because you've refused to get vaccinated, as if somehow your refusal is based upon some political or ideological motive, instead of, hey, three kids all got the vaccine, decided that the fourth wasn't going to get it because the first three all had adverse effects, including autism. Did the homework and found out, I know more than you do as a parent about what you're putting into my body, nurse, physician, pediatrician, and pharmacist. Well, then you're coming from a place of intentional awareness, intentional knowledge that displaces the old biases and propaganda. So shouldn't we actually promote greater awareness? Not if the overarching agenda is keep the people calm, tame, distracted. Edward Bernays laid out the blueprint and everyone's perfected it since. So that's why we make so many wrong choices. Just the government, the fact that they would give out to the very people, like Bernanke was one later, but the people who headed the Federal Reserve, Alan Greenspan, and the people heading the Treasury, Paulson, and then Geithner. Well, these people were responsible for the way the banking industry ended up collapsing on itself. They were bailed out. Think of that for a moment. Wrap your mind around. Wall Street does not represent the financial stability of the average person. Their only interest is making money for themselves and those people that give them large amounts of money to manage for them. But above what they give back to the people who invest, they're always making money first for themselves. That's the game of Wall Street. Now, if you make mistakes and you bet on the wrong side of an issue, like options or derivatives, and you go broke, shouldn't you be responsible for absorbing those losses and go out of business? Because if you're a baker, if you're a restaurant, if you're a dry cleaner, if you're a little movie theater, if you're an art shop, and you open up on the wrong side of a street in the wrong neighborhood, if you don't have enough investment capital to sustain yourself for 6 months that every small business person should have before they go into business, if you're flying by the seat of your pants and you're still not succeeding, the government will not come in and bail you out. It doesn't do that. If you're a homeowner and you're underwater in your mortgage and now you're getting hounded that you got to pay your mortgage and they're not going to forgive it, and then the mortgage company writes it off and turns it over for collection, they're going to throw you out. And they threw 7 million families out, which meant that about 23 million Americans now were without a place to live. They didn't come and save those people. That's not their responsibility, they're going to tell you. But it is certainly the responsibility to bail out Wall Street. The very people who caused the problem are the people that are being bailed out. So you see, that doesn't make any sense. It's all wrong. Everything we're doing is wrong. Every institution has betrayed us. The people running these institutions have betrayed us. So I'm very concerned that we're not doing critical enough thinking. And those who are excluded from the conversation. They're washed off Facebook. They're censored off Google. They're attacked and vilified on Wikipedia. So the best and brightest, the real best and brightest, not Halberstam's, you know, the best and brightest like McNamara and Kennedy, but the really the best minds we have, like a Chris Hedges, they're excluded, they're censored, they're attacked, they're destroyed, as if they were an enemy and we're going after them. That's where we're at today. Why? Why? So when I hear all this, I don't become emotionally involved in it. I simply tell the truth about it, and then I stay emotionally nutrient from it. It's removed from it. I'm not changing it. No one's going to change because of me. No institution's going to change. So what I can do is I can stay neutral. I can report on what's bad. I can give what is good. I can share positive solutions. But I'm not going to become a ball in a tennis match being bounced between the problem and the solution, the problem and the solution. And imagine how frustrating it is if you have positive solutions no one's paying attention to. So that's where we're at today. And that's why I want you to read that article. Go to prn.fm. It's posted. But then ask yourself, why do you believe people are not willing to take the time and effort to go to neutral and deconstruct their own values and belief systems to see if anything in their belief system has caused their problems? And what do they need to do to have a different mindset to change their problem to a solution? Okay, I'd like to hear from you. 888-874-4888. And finally, a few more issues on health and nutrition. There's an effect now of low-dose intake of phosphatidylserine and curcumin to help cognitive function and to prevent Alzheimer's. This is in Kyoto University in Japan. So that's good news, and it reinforces what many of us, helping people with Alzheimer's and dementia, have found, that when you take all the things like curcumin that will turn off inflammation in the brain, and you give it to them, and phosphatidylserine that helps rebalance the brain, then you're on the right side of this issue. And also there is what is called ferulic acid, F-E-R-U-L-I-C. It also is very important in this process. So if you have dementia or Alzheimer's, someone in your family does, recommend ferulic acid, phosphatidylserine, and curcumin for helping them. And the latest study just out shows that we're going to double the amount of Alzheimer's and dementia patients in the near future. Double it. Wow. That's a big problem coming at us. And also, University of Canada showed that poor diet and stress and inactivity converge to form a perfect storm that drives Alzheimer's disease pathogenesis. So that's one of the reasons you have to change that diet and change your stress and how you respond to stress and become more active. And that will help. I'm Gary Null. That's the latest on health and nutrition. And we're going to take a break. And when we come back, we're going to go right into a short spot. This is from Honest Government, and it's looking at our healthcare system. Back in a moment. Please stay with us. See ya! See ya! Yeah! Yeah! Yeah!
Sinistica's latest attempt to strip you of your health care. Now you can finally relax and let down your guard. Because after 7 long years of trying to undo the legacy of that brutal Muslim Kenyan dictator, we realize it's finally time for us to move on to something else. Such as sabotaging Obamacare to justify our next attempt to strip you of your health care and replace it with wealth care. Do you suffer from a pre-existing condition such as not being rich? No problem. Unlike complex Obamacare, wealth care offers a simple solution. If you ain't as rich as Mitch McConnell, just fin die. No mess, no fuss. That's right. By leaving over 20 million more of you uninsured, cutting Medicaid, raising premiums, and discriminating against a raft of pre-existing conditions, wealth care should kill at least 36,000 of you annually. That's 12 9/11s each year, which might sound like a lot of dead people, but it's a sacrifice we're willing to make to protect innocent Americans from socialism. We know we've struggled recently to pass wealth care in the Senate, but rest assured, we won't stop till we repeal Obamacare. And what's that? What you really want is Medicare for all, like most other civilized nations in the world? Aw, sweetheart, you know there's no money for that. But hey, here are some things we do have money for. Trump's visits to Mar-a-Lago, Trump's golf games, big boat that shoots million-dollar missiles, more of these useless pieces of maintaining the American empire, and of course, $3.2 trillion for the most expensive healthcare in the world, when Medicare for all would cost only half that much. Wealthcare. Who needs healthcare anyway when you have Jesus? Authorized by the Department of Wealth.
All right. These Australians have a good sense of humor, and they're right on the money. By the way, yesterday when I was giving my commentary, I mentioned that we are completely, totally bankrupt in the United States. There are individuals who are not. There are large hedge funds, equity partnerships, some major corporations are doing extremely well and will continue. But overall, we are completely, totally bankrupt, and we're hypocritical about it, meaning we're lecturing the world, we're virtue-shaming the world that they should be more like us and free market enterprise and get away from socialism. Well, these are people who, unfortunately, are not looking at the fact that Sweden is not a socialist state, nor is Norway, nor is Finland. They have thriving but conscientious capitalist systems. They're what we might call an ethical capitalist society. That produces the income, and then they're paying and voluntarily paying or willingly paying a large percentage of that in taxes. They don't have a big military-industrial complex to support. They don't have all the lobbyists. In fact, in Norway and another country, they're not given perks. They're not given cars. They take buses and ride bikes to their legislators to work each day. They don't become millionaires like all of ours do. But I want to be very specific and tell you why you cannot trust anything that the media or the government tells you. Our actual unemployment level is 22%. But you add this up, all right? And you're not going to get these figures anywhere else. And this is from the national debt clock. These are accurate figures. Our national debt is $23 trillion. But the total U.S. debt is $74 trillion. State debt is $1.2 trillion, with $6.8 trillion unfunded pensions. So what's going to happen when, even though there's constitutional requirements in many states, like Texas, for example, in California, I believe in New York, that you must pay anyone who's retired, not just their pension required, but also the interest, in some cases high as 8% every year. Well, what if they don't have the money? Then you can look forward in the future to those pensions being challenged in court. Local debt at the city level is $1.2 trillion. Social Security liabilities, $20 trillion. Medicare liabilities, $31 trillion. U.S. unfunded liabilities, we don't have enough money to pay for these liabilities, is $126.5 trillion. $6.9 trillion of the debt is held by foreign nations in the way of treasury bonds. Mortgage debt for homeowners is $15.8 trillion. Student debt is $1.6 trillion. Credit card debt is $1.1 trillion. So listen carefully. In addition, last month, the Securities and Exchange Commission Chairman Jay Clayton announced that America's corporate debt has reached nearly $10 trillion, which is about half the nation's annual gross domestic product. That leaves national debt of the entire United States at $244 trillion. So how much more debt needs to be piled up before we begin to realize we are totally bankrupt? It is obscene that the Fed, the Federal Reserve, would be handing out $100 billion every 24 hours, as they're doing right now, to corporations while the rest of the nation morphs into a banana republic. It is a frightening reality that the majority of Americans refuse to face. We are being distracted by assuming that the only problem we have is to replace an incompetent, intellectually challenged president who is simply a product and the symptom of past White House mistakes and neglect and failures to honor the pledges made over the last 40 years to the average Americans. Democrats delude themselves into believing that getting Trump removed from office will remedy everything. Certainly, this failure to see behind the curtain is a harbinger for the rapid decline of the American empire. So the next time someone says, "We're doing great," by which metric are you measuring it? We just gave you the facts. Now, if our gross domestic product is around $21 trillion, that means you're already at 500% in the first $100 trillion, 1,000% in the second $100 trillion, and approximately two additional rolls. So we're at 1,200% debt to gross domestic product. We thought Greece was a complete basket case when it reached 200% debt to gross domestic product. Italy's right behind it, as is France and Ireland. And we are the biggest debtor in the world. No one owes the debt we do. So we're living off credit cards. We're living off loans. And it's not working. Yet no one is talking about what we can do to change it. Now, I mentioned that we were going to have a little input today by people who can tell you how they're doing, what they've learned, and how they feel. I haven't spoken with them, but they're downstairs. I'm upstairs where I have a portable studio, and they're downstairs sitting around a kitchen table. So I don't know who's going to be on the line, but we'll find out in a moment. Who's on the line right now, please?
Hi, Gary. It's John C. here.
Hi, John.
Hi.
Tell us about what has changed.
What has changed is, number one, the amount of energy that I have. I'm power walking. We started out with about 4 miles a day, and I'm up to 7 to 8 miles per day. I don't have a dip in energy during the afternoon. I go to the gym after I have a smoothie and some fruit in the morning after power walking, and do a very heavy workout. And again, I don't feel tired. I don't feel hungry, even though we're just having smoothies and fruit during the day. We have our other meal around 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and then a little bit of fruit afterwards. But and I have a lightness in the way that I think. And I think that is the biggest challenge for me, that I have a lot of negative thoughts that would make me feel awful, especially in my gut, which I have no issues with anymore since I've been here. Gut is absolutely fine. But it's the negative thoughts, so that my conditioned mind, I feel right now, is changing to a more authentic mind, so that I feel more confident. I feel more ease, at ease with things in the way that I think. That's the biggest change for me, and that's a huge change for me.
Because from what I understand, you've spent much of your adult life suffering from intermittent depression, correct?
Yes, I did. Massive depression at times. I was tried almost every SSRI that was out there, but the side effects were overwhelming, even though maybe they did help me a little bit. But for the most part, I just felt like a zombie. I did get through the day. I did sleep at night, but it wasn't with a kind of pleasure that I would normally have during the day. So
in the last 5 weeks, have you suffered from depression?
No, not at all. And you have been very challenging in a lot of your discussions with us, and it's uncomfortable. But I'm getting the idea that uncomfortable is not a bad thing. It's how you get through that uncomfortable part when in the changing from the conditioned mind to a more authentic mind that the after you go through that uncomfortableness, there's authenticity behind that.
Good for you. Thank you, John. Hand the phone to the next person, please.
I'm going to hand the phone to Pietra.
Good morning, Gary.
Hi, Pietra. Tell us what you've noticed being here.
Okay. I've noticed, first and foremost, because every 2 weeks we have a physical assessment. And I remember doing the assessment the first time, and just to do a full sit-up, my body felt so heavy, and I had some aches and pains in my joints to reach up and do maybe 10, 15 sit-ups. And then when we had our reassessment, and only 2 weeks later, I could do these full sit-ups with ease. It surprised me. I was like, whoa, is this the same body? Because it was only 2 weeks. I wasn't expecting that much improvement. But not only did I improve with my sit-ups, for example, we had to do squats, and I think I started with like 17 squats. After 2 weeks, I did about 181 squats. And I'm doing the squats, and I'm thinking to myself, what the heck is going on here? I couldn't believe the improvement. And it's so amazing to know that if you really dedicate yourself to eating right, and like John said, we're eating one meal a day that is so delicious and so dense with nutrition, which consists of like a soup, a hearty salad, and a main course. And then you fill that in the rest of the day, you fill it in with juices and smoothies. It's amazing. And daily, you know, exercise, a good 2 hours or so, how quickly you can get results. And I'm just comparing this with friends that I know who, you know, do Weight Watchers and have been trying to lose 5 pounds for 6 months. You know, they go in there for their monthly weigh-in and, oh, I lost 1 pound. Oh, I went up 1 pound. Oh, I lost a half a pound. Oh, I went up 2 pounds. And I'm thinking, wow, if you really dedicate yourself to taking care of yourself and eating right, you can get results that people are waiting for 6 to 8 months in 2 to 4 weeks. So,
did you notice the woman who was at the retreat lost 22 pounds in 2 weeks?
Yes. When I heard that, I made it a point to take a second look at her, and I was like, wow, because I couldn't believe you could lose that much weight so quickly. But when I saw her, I did see she looked smaller, and I was like, my goodness. And, you know, it's crazy. We have such an industry, and God knows how much is spent annually on weight loss, right? People trying to lose weight. And here, this is not rocket science. We're just eating right, having fruit every day, having smoothies, exercising, and it's so effective, and it's so easy. So anybody could do it.
That's terrific. Also, very briefly, one exception to the protocol is we're giving the same identical protocol that everyone else is on. That's what you do in a clinical study. You can't have people on different protocols. But there is one person who had end-stage near-death dementia, and that's Pieta's mother. And she's been taking care of her for the last 7 years, which has virtually consumed her whole life. And she was completely gone when she arrived. No eye contact, staring at the ground, screaming inconsolably and uncontrollably, waking everyone up 4 times a night. And now what's happened in the last 4 weeks?
In the last 4 weeks, first thing I've noticed is that her eyes seem to have more life. She seems to have more motor function with her eyes. When she looks at you, it's just such a pleasure to see her open her eyes. And, you know, it just... it's almost like when you have better motor function and you're wide-eyed, it's almost like you've taken 8 years off your life, you know, because you have better focus. You can maintain eye contact with someone when they're talking to you. You have attention. And before, her eyes would be everywhere. You could talk to her, and she might respond with her gibberish, but she wouldn't be looking at you. She's in her own little world. So her motor function has definitely improved. Her focus has definitely improved. Her attention span is better than what it was. Also before, her moods were very erratic, literally from a minute to the next. People would say, oh, she's happy. I'm like, oh, no, you just wait. You know, and in a moment, it could change at any moment. And it would. She'd be laughing and happy 1 second and crying the next. And this was her day, you know, all day long. And now her moods are stabilizing. She is quieter and calmer for longer periods of time. I'm not saying it's always, but the calmness is lasting a little longer. And let me tell you, for a caretaker, that is so wonderful, you know, because even when I go out to do my workouts, I worry, is she back there crying and annoying everybody? And now I come back and she's just sitting in her chair and she's totally fine. And so it's like such a relief, you know, and I don't have to be so preoccupied that that she's not okay. And also at nighttime, when she would have her bowel movements, she would wake up crying, and that's how it would wake me up. That's how I knew she had a bowel movement. She would wake up crying, moaning and groaning, and then I'd have to maneuver her. And if you maneuver someone who has Alzheimer's, usually they don't like to be touched. You're not hurting them at all, but they don't like being touched or moved, and they start screaming. Now, when she has a bowel movement, she wakes me up with laughter. So I can't tell you how much better it is, you know, to be woken up. When you're tired, it's much better to be woken up with laughter than someone screaming and crying and moaning and groaning, you know, because you're already being tested because you're not getting a full night's sleep. And on top of that, to have someone constantly crying and screaming is it's a true test of your patience, believe me. So that is another... That's taken so much stress off of me, you know, and this is just after perhaps a 3 solid weeks of supplements and eating right. And another thing, she was not being hydrated properly. Here she's drinking about 1/2 gallon of water. So it's making a big difference.
Did John mention the other, who was just on the phone, and he's Italian, did he mention that he wanted to give your mother a drink, and the mother actually spoke to him and said, no, I don't want that. So that's a big door opening.
Yeah, absolutely. These little moments of lucidity throughout the day are very, very exciting. It's interesting what we take for granted, you know, when someone doesn't have their mind and suddenly they start saying something that makes sense, it is such a gift. And it's so precious to, you know, for loved ones to hear things like that. It means the world to us.
It's one building. It's rebuilding the brain, one molecule at a time. So pay attention to these small things, because everyone's noticed she's happier, she's calmer, she's smiling, she gives you full eye contact, and so that's important. So thank you, Pieta.
You're welcome. Do you want to speak to Katinka?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll pass you on.
All right.
Hi,
this
Gary.
Will be the last one. Hi, Katinka.
Yes.
Tell us what's changed.
Oh, there's so many things. When I came here, I had come out of physical therapy, and I was advised to use a walker. And when I was not so enthusiastic about using a walker, I was told at least I had a cane. But even though I wanted to improve, I didn't really improve. Not as much as I wanted to. Well, here I am walking 2 miles a day, and I am much better, and every day I'm just getting better and better. I had piano legs when I came here. I don't have them anymore. The incredible energy is just, you can't even put a word in it, because it's, you just feel it in every part of your body. I'm developing muscle mass, which I had none of when I came. I'm hoping to gain much more weight. I've had a very limited diet, being tied to a lot of allergies. And Gary has really encouraged me to put that all aside and try and go for the food and the supplements. And in doing that, I am eating more foods than I haven't had foods like that in 30 years. Besides the cooking, all Gary's recipes, just, if you went to the best restaurant, you couldn't get better. It's just really delicious. And I'm enjoying the amazing effects of it. I also really enjoy the motivation in just being quiet, just meditating. I find that incredible, the effects that it has. And
Katinka, how about when you were out there in the gym doing the tug of war with a rope?
Oh, that is so funny.
You realize that the side you was on, the moment you got your hands on that rope, started pulling it, you were able to help pull the other people across that line. Well, thank you very much, Katinka, for sharing your views. Yes, what were you going to say?
I was just going to say that a talk about your wonderful motivational talks. I hear the creative way all the time in everything that you're saying. I can reassociate it very easily to my own work, and I really enjoy your interpretation of lifestyle and what we all can do every day in our thinking and doing. That's a treasure.
Now, no one has called in. I'd hope someone would call in and give us your opinions. Why, you know, good people do bad things, smart people do stupid things, and as a society we resist change even when it's our own best interest. But if you decide to call in, I'll be happy to put you on the air. I want to now play a clip, and this is an important one. This is about people struggling to make a living, and this is in Anaheim, California. Low-wage workers struggle to keep a roof over their heads, but this is not being covered in any of the mainstream media. We'll go to that clip now.
Stable, affordable place to live. Many of them low-wage workers. Special correspondent Kat Wise has a report from Anaheim, California, as part of our ongoing Chasing the Dream series.
There's a lot to be happy about in Anaheim, California. A record-breaking 24.2 million tourists visited the city and its well-known theme parks last year. Unemployment is low, hotels are full, restaurants are busy, and there's no shortage of smiles. But away from the palm tree-lined main streets, there are neighborhoods not often seen by tourists, where tens of thousands of workers live who play a vital role in the region's booming economy. Many are making around minimum wage, $11 an hour, and housing is often a daily challenge. Converted garages, motel rooms, spare bedrooms, cars, and tents have become shelters of necessity in this area, which has some of the highest housing costs in the country.
The housing wage, that is how much someone has to make per hour to afford a basic apartment, is $24 to $26 an hour. And the folks who live in this area earn somewhere between $11 to $13 an hour.
Jose Moreno is an Anaheim City Council member who represents a district with a large number of low-income workers. Last year, Anaheim declared a homeless state of emergency, and he led a task force to study the problem.
The wages have stagnated, although unemployment's going down. Housing costs are going up. If you're not paying your workers a wage they could live on in the local economy, then that creates a lot of stress on the social system of the city.
You got a feather.
One of those who is struggling is 58-year-old Glendana Shevlin, who has worked at Disneyland for 30 years. She's a full-time host in a VIP lounge at one of the resort's hotels, and she's a member of a labor union which represents Disney hotel and restaurant workers.
I love my job. I love the guests that come in. I have a panoramic view of downtown Disney and both the parks.
While Shevlin loves her job and the health insurance she receives, she doesn't love her pay. She makes $15.70 an hour. She has struggled for years to find stable, affordable housing. Last summer, a friend rented her a bedroom, a significant improvement over other places she stayed, including a shelter for women, motels, and friends' couches. But Shevlin says she's barely making it month to month.
At work, I'm happy-go-lucky. I look good. I look like I live a privileged life. But actually, to tell you the truth, when I come home, it's a struggle. I haven't been able to shop this week. I couldn't pay rent this month. Things keep going up, but wages aren't. I feel like I'm a working poor, which is an oxymoron. That you should not have to be poor when you're working. I mean, I'm working 40 hours a week.
It's not hard to find others who are facing similar employment and housing hardships. In a nearby community, a $1,000 a month converted garage with an outside shower and no kitchen is the current home of Lupe Acevedo, her mom and five children. The family receives government assistance, but Acevedo also works two minimum wage jobs at a small store and a food truck. Last year, they were in a motel, and when we visited, she was worried she might have to move again.
My kids, they tell me, Mom, is this going to be our life? Or they're like afraid to live in the streets. I'll do anything so that they could get a roof.
Although low hourly wages are common throughout every sector of the economy, Orange County's largest employer, Disneyland, attracts a lot of attention. 30,000 full and part-time employees, known as cast members, work there. A recent survey of the company's union employees, about 5,000 of whom responded, found more than 85% earn less than $15 an hour, and almost three-quarters said they do not earn enough money for basic expenses every month.
11% of Disney workers have been homeless at some point in the last 2 years.
Late last month, the survey's authors from Occidental College and the nonprofit Economic Roundtable presented their findings to a packed crowd. The survey was requested and funded by a coalition of resort labor unions, two of which are currently in contract negotiations with Disney. Disney declined to do an on-camera interview, but provided this statement. This inaccurate and unscientific survey was paid for by politically motivated labor unions, and its results are deliberately distorted and do not reflect how the overwhelming majority of our 30,000 cast members feel about the company. While we recognize that socioeconomic challenges exist for many people living in Southern California, we take pride in our employment experience. Disney also noted it has created 4,000 jobs in the last 5 years, more than any other business in Orange County, and it's launching a new higher education and vocational training program for hourly workers.
It's bigger than one company.
Tom Tate is Anaheim's mayor. He favors higher wages, but he says the problem of affordable housing cannot be easily solved by local government.
We have a tough time affecting the price of housing. With land so expensive, it's very difficult to build something that is affordable. The problem is system-wide. I mean, everything's expensive. So we can, you know, help a few families here or there, but to help the thousands that we're talking about, tens of thousands, I don't see where, I mean, there's nowhere near that kind of funding.
In the past, Anaheim did have more money to help build affordable apartment complexes like this one, using state redevelopment funds. But that money largely dried up in 2012. According to city records, just 300 units for low and very low-income renters were built or rehabbed between 2014 and 2016. Some 30,000 are now on a city waitlist for affordable housing, and 20,000 are on a waitlist for Section 8 federal housing vouchers. Jose Moreno is one of the...
Okay, two solutions that are self-evident. All those 30,000 people should be organized and have a general strike against Disney. But do your homework first, and you'll find, as I have, the billions of dollars that Disney makes in profit, the tens of millions of dollars it gives to its executives, including President Disney, the money it has from its other subsidiaries, including ABC Network, and that the only concern Disney has is providing shareholder profit. They have a lot of institutional investors, meaning here's the irony. A lot of school teachers or firefighters or community workers or state workers, they have pensions, which is good. But now those pensions want to get a higher return, so they invest in pharmaceutical companies and armament companies and companies like Disney, and because they'll get a return more than what they would in someplace else. Well, at what point do we, the people, start to realize that for us to have what we want, maybe that deprives someone else for what they need? And therefore, by having a strike and bringing these statistics to the public's and media's attention, it might force them, out of nothing else than embarrassment, that they have created such income inequality and exploited their workers, thinking the worker is desperate and there's no other work around. That's one option. The second option is to give any company in the state where you're looking to do this a 2-to-1 tax break. Because, A, they're not going to pay taxes to begin with if they're a smart company, and that's unfortunate. That's why I recommend a flat tax they can't deduct anything from. They got to pay it. But if they were able to collect, and it would be in the neighborhood of $5 billion, they could build up the entire state of California, San Francisco, down through the Silicon Valley, down through Los Angeles and Santa Barbara, San Jose, down to San Diego. They could build people's villages, completely self-sustaining, powered by solar and geothermal, because they've got geothermal streams up and down the state. They could have community gardens, they could have clinics, they could have schools, and they could give quality life, not in some sterile, building, but rather in, and it would be no more expensive to build these, in giving people little villas, and they're made out of concrete, so they're fireproof. And you put solar to run the whole thing, and then a family could live together with some quality of life. If you have four kids, you could have everything from four bedrooms to one bedroom. You could put 2,000 to 3,000 people in each one of those. So you could house about 100,000 homeless people or people who are working, the working poor, if you decided you cared enough about them to not make it political, but make it humanistic and humanitarian. If they want to know how to do it, I've done plans on it. I'll be happy to share it with any community planning board in the United States. Now, wrapping up our program today, we're going to do a little fundraising for the R Station because we're trying to go 24/7 live, which means we will be hiring some extra engineers, and therefore you can have a lot more programming than what you have now, because I want a lot of people to come in and use the studios instead of having it on archive. So I came up with a really good special, and what's interesting, this special's been out of stock for over 4 months, and it's because we make small batches. This is 3,500 bottles. That's a tiny, what is called a run. Generally, there are 100,000 to a million bottles of other companies, but we like it fresh, and this is Heavenly Aloe. It's back in stock, but we decided to give you a free DVD of your choice, all right? And the aloe vera, it's a combined value of $188.97. You buy two, you get one free, and today only. So you're going to only pay $76.78. It's worth $188, $189. So you're getting over $110 or about $105 as a gift in product. Now, why is my aloe vera? And I did a lot of research. I had to fly to the Dominican Republic, went all around the United States to see, are the aloes all the same? And they are not. Mine is grown certified organic in the Rio Grande Valley of Texas. It's not grown in the Dominican Republic or other places that don't have our standards. Now, there's a lot of different types of aloe vera, but I wanted the highest biologically valued aloe in the world. And what I came up with is the Pathogenesis leaf. And so that is grown, it's harvested at 3 years, it goes into a factory right there, and it's pressed, and the alanine comes out. That's what causes upset stomach and most of the other aloes. And then you get natural Bing cherry concentrate, raspberry and black cherry natural concentrate, Siberian ginseng root extract, gota cola, one of the most important herbs in the world for women, wild yam root extract, ginger extract, peppermint leaf extract, and that's what you get in this 100% aloe vera juice concentrate, and it's got the highest rating. I remember when we said, how do we rate against everyone else? And the International Aloe Research Council came in and gave us, this is as good as it gets. So it tastes delicious, and it's a big container. And just Google aloe vera nutrient ingredients, and you'll see why all those things like gota cola and wild yam and ginger were put in here. And then you'll know why this is the best. But here's what we're going to do. I've already done it. If you go to prn.fm or garynull.com, and it says about the aloe vera, you click there. You'll see a big banner, aloe vera. Click there, and you're going to see a documentary, a mini documentary on aloe vera, the whole history of it. But more importantly, we got a low-flying plane that flew about 100 feet off the ground and filmed the whole 1,200 acres and the people cutting and taking you into the factory and showing you every single step, including the rabbi with every run. And he certifies everything as certified kosher and how it's produced right up to the finished bottle. I don't know anyone else is willing to take you behind the scenes and show you how their products are made. But when I say that mine's the Rolls Royce of all products, yeah, it is. And we stand behind it. Now, could I have aloe vera brought in from China? Yeah. And would I know what's in it? No. And would I dare drink it? I wouldn't drink anything from China. But this is made in the USA, certified organic, and you get to see the video. Plus, I did, before I left New York for this retreat, I did a whole discussion of what aloe vera is important for, and this aloe vera in particular. So, it's back after 4 months. It's one of our best-selling products for the last 30 years. And you're getting a huge saving. You're buying two and getting one free. And you're getting a DVD of your choice. I've got like 50 DVDs or so. You can choose which one you want, and that's my gift to you. But you got to call this number. And we have two wonderful people standing by, Diane and Sandy. And the number to call is 877-627-5065. Again, 877-627-5065. In case you didn't get your pen in time, 877-627-5065. And we, when we have a premium that we send it out, we can send it out within 24 hours. So right now, if you're going to call, there's a high probability it'll go out the door today, if not by the latest tomorrow. That's how quickly you're going to get this. You're going to get it as fast as Amazon will give you a product from the time you place an order. That's how fast we are now. Now we're doing our own fulfillment in our own warehouse. So call and get your aloe vera. It's been out of stock for a while because it has to be in season. If it's not in season, then we have to wait till it is, but we've got it back. Heavenly Aloe, one of the people's favorites and one of the best, most healthy, important products you can put in your body every day. I take it on wherever I go. Now, I can't take it on an airplane, but I have it shipped to wherever I'm going to be. And I have a whole lot down here, and I take it every day. So get your aloe vera. Watch the video. Watch the video. See every single step of the process. And then say, who else is willing to do that? No, they're not. We are. 877-627-5065 and save over $100 with this offer. How about that? Thank you all for listening, and have a nice day.